and welcome to Build. I'm Harriet Rose, and as always, we are live from London. Today, I'm delighted to be joined by two of the members of the much-loved British band that has achieved global success with such hits as Pompeii, Bad Blood, and Joy. They are back with a critically acclaimed new album, but before we get them on, let's check out those nights from their new album, Doom Days.
The lights, the lights, the lights. They cut a path across the road. A blinding look from me to you, and I'll be your rabbit in the headlights. We'll never get to heaven. I'll be your rabbit in the headlights. We'll never get to those nights when your friends are gone and you're holding on for someone to leave with. Those nights when you crave so long to be there at dawn to wake me. 'Cause are we all just looking for a little bit of hope these days? Looking for somebody we can wake up with. Looking for a little bit of hope these days. We are.
Please welcome to the studio Dan and Will from Bastille. Lovely to see you both. We've all been singing along in here.
No,
it's been great. They're a lot better singers than I am, though. How are you guys doing?
Yeah, good.
Good,
yeah?
Thanks.
How are you?
So, as ever, if you're watching live, remember, tweet your questions, Build London. Tweet your questions to Build Series London or leave a comment under the video if you're watching on Facebook. Sorry, back to you guys. Enough of that over. How are you guys doing? And also, before we start, Dan and Will, you're obviously here, but what have you done with the other two? Where are Kyle and Woody?
They're just lazy.
Oh.
They wanted a lie-in.
Oh, really?
A lie-in at what time?
Because, yeah. Dan, I've seen before, talking of the lazy stuff, you're quite often late, is
yeah.
that right?
I'm a busy guy.
Not being funny, on time, everyone. On time today. Look, he's here.
It says a horrible thing about your character if you get an applause for being on time.
No, listen, I'm here for it. I think it's very important to praise. I'm always late, so I'm trying to back you up here.
Thanks, I appreciate it.
So obviously, let's get straight to it. The new album is incredible, Doom Dames. It's a triumph, and it's got a lot of the kind of mix of genres and styles inside the album is really exciting for me. It's got a lot of 90s breakbeats, UK garage hooks, and a lot of clever pop culture kind of referencing as well in there. How is it different from your previous two, in your guys' opinion?
Good question.
Look at it, beautiful. Look at that.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, let's just look at that for a while.
Yeah. in fact, just don't worry about the interview.
How is it different? I guess one of the things that feels different is previously most of the backing vocals I've kind of done myself, because our band sort of started as a bedroom project, and so a lot of the layering was out of necessity. But with this album, because it's this sort of communal night out, we wanted it to feel like there was a cast of characters. So there's all these different voices wandering in and out, and I think it's the first time we've really had that in an album, and hopefully it adds to the texture and it's a bit warmer because of that. What do you think, Will?
I concur. I think also, sonically, it's a bit of a departure from certainly the second album, where we sort of put a load of guitars on. And then this one, we've kind of gone more electronic almost, because it's sort of meant to be paying homage to 90s sort of dance music. So it's kind of perhaps less bandy sounding than the other two, which were quite sort of band sounding.
It's definitely it's like a real progression as well. It's kind of nice that you say your first two albums, like as you say, you started off as a bedroom project, and here you are adding all these elements that kind of like the grandeur is getting more and more, which is kind of nice to see that elevation as a band, right?
Yeah, I guess we're such a weird band in that we've never had like. I looked at albums that were massive when we started, which was like the first, you know, the first Vampire Weekend album, the XX's first album. There were these acts that were coming out with a really sort of tight, they were like three pieces or four pieces, and they had a really distinct sound. And across their first albums, it all kind of sounded the same, but the songs were so good that it sort of took you through it. And we were almost the opposite of that, in that every song sounded sort of different, and we used different things in each song. Because I'd always loved sort of film soundtracks, and I think I've completely lost my thread. I don't even know what I'm talking about.
Well, it was what I'm here with you in every like, moment because it was a
as in you're also
thread.
Completely lost.
No, no, I know where we are. But I was lost with you in the moment.
Oh, thanks.
But I do think with this album, you kind of touch on the state of the planet in a way, like the doomsday element. Was it a conscious decision to tackle kind of global issues? Because I know your second album was deliberately political, whereas this one it wasn't necessarily a deliberate choice. It was more just how it became. You know, the statement that came from what you made.
Yeah, I mean, particularly the song Doom Days, which was the last song that we added. I think we just felt like if we were going to make an album that was looking at escapism and both on like a personal level, you know, trying to escape your problems and but also, the realities of the world that you can't help but have seep in via like the internet, via Twitter, via your phone, via like news alerts. It felt kind of hollow to do this album that was all about sort of escaping and losing your mind and not address some of the things you might want to be escaping. It felt kind of like a bit of a cop-out. But sometimes it takes that, I think, in making an album. Like a lot of people always say like the single or the biggest song on the record or the most important one sometimes comes as the last thing because you've sort of relaxed a bit and I think the pressure's off. And then you often end up coming up with this really important song. And you know, Doom Days isn't like the single, but it I think in stepping back from the album, it gave us the opportunity to think about all the things we hadn't said on it that we wanted to. And I guess in going into releasing an album, promoting it, it was so satisfying having that song because I could kind of just, you know, we just put it out and it were like, this says a lot of what we're thinking. It speaks for itself.
It's poignant, isn't it? In this time as well, it's poignant.
I think when we released our second album, there was a lot of conversation around these huge changes happening in the world and how few musicians were kind of saying anything about it. And I don't know if that comes from people not feeling like it's their place or not knowing how to articulate it or worrying a little bit about pissing people off. But we sort of started to, and I always felt a bit reluctant because, you know, I'm always aware. Are we allowed to swear, by the way?
Yeah. Cool. You are now.
Right.
You are now. They've changed the rules for you.
You're always wary of that dickhead in a band who's using their position to sort of I don't know. You just don't want to be preachy, do you?
So, no, but I think David Attenborough would be a big fan. I'm not just saying like.
Oh, that's great.
Listen, that's.
I watched him at Glastonbury. Never thought I'd be watching David Attenborough on the Pyramids stage.
It made me cry.
Yeah.
Honestly, what a guy. Is it true that you had a version ready to go? Okay. Mic drop. If I was allowed to drop the mic, I would and leave. True you had a version of the album, but you decided to kind of go back and revisit it and develop it further before you released it?
Yeah.
We did early last year a tour called the Reorchestrated Tour, which is where we brought a string quartet and some brass players and the choir that we ended up working with a lot. And I think it was after that we realised that there was, like Dan was saying earlier, there's such a sort of scope to include these other voices, particularly given that the theme of the concept of the album is to do with being at a party. It just seemed, you know, an opportunity to really capture that sort of collaborative spirit and that party atmosphere. It was kind of a tricky decision, but then we were like, well, it's ultimately going to make it a better piece of work. I can imagine it would be quite frustrating if you're waiting for an album to come out and it's about to come out and then the band's like, oh, give us a year, we're going to completely redo it. But I think ultimately it was worth it because I think what we ended up producing was far better. Because it had other people on rather than just us.
And a bunch of different, you know, some songs came off, some songs went on. We sort of reordered things, rewrote a lot of lyrics. And yeah, it's kind of, what's weird about our third album was the idea initially was to make this like short 8-track album that came out straight away and was like a snapshot of our thought process for a minute. And then we could move straight on to the next one. And like, as seems to always happen with us, it turned into a 3-year process.
Do you know what? Whatever you did, it worked.
But I think it's better for it. And it's, you know, I guess, you know, how people release music and consume music now is so like open and free and it allowed us to go away and do some collaborations and make another mixtape and work on all these different things at once. And hopefully we're like better for it.
Well, we're better for it because the album is sick.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Exactly, to whoever that was. As touching on what we were just talking about, the album explores sort of loose and messy nights of self-indulgence. And it's kind of set during the potential, maybe the end of the world. What was the kind of process behind picking that as the idea around the album? Was there a kind of moment, or was it just a natural?
Yeah, I think a bunch of the songs were about escapism, and then I guess the idea of it being a sort of loose story came about and just seemed like a really fun thing to engage with. And I don't know, I think a lot of people sort of care less about albums nowadays. There's loads of huge artists who've sort of stopped making them. And so we thought, let's just do the opposite and double down on making an album, even though no one cares.
We care.
And the idea of it being a sort of concept album to a point, it just allowed us to set it in this really real, messy, hopefully quite relatable setting and drawing on quite a lot of experience. And then, talking about bigger topics that are tricky to talk about without sounding pompous, but using quite like pedestrian every day, every night sort of situations. And it was just fun. It was really fun to have this almost like a kind of film in our heads that you're like filling in the gaps for.
And you, as you said, Doom Days was the last track you added.
Yeah.
Did you write that on the way to Australia? Is that right?
Yeah, we did. We had an afternoon in the studio. This is a really long, boring story. I'll try to tell it quickly. But we had to, our album was getting mastered on the Monday. And the previous Tuesday, I was like, right, guys, there's an extra song I want to add to the album. And everyone
God.
Rolls their eyes. And they're like, oh, here we are again. We went into the studio and everybody put their parts down. And the producer that we work with was in America working on something else. So we thought we'd chuck everything down, send it to him, and be like, your problem.
Bye.
And he's like, great, thanks. I just couldn't. I couldn't nail the lyrics, so I wrote way too many verses and recorded them all about 50 times.
Was it like 30 something?
It was 30, yeah. And then that night, we then had to fly to Australia. And we had this ridiculous tour of Australia. We did 3 gigs in 3 days. So we flew in, show, and then back home again.
Oh my gosh.
On the plane, I couldn't stop thinking about the song and wrote like a load more. And then in Australia, I had to find a studio to go into between soundcheck and the gig, and just got there and was like, hey, you're going to think I'm completely crazy. Just going to sing some really intense state of the world lyrics at you for a while and then fuck off back to the gig that we're about to do. Sorry, mate. But they were really lovely about it. And then we were sort of sending stuff from London to Melbourne, then on to LA where Mark was, and which makes us sound way cooler and more international than we are.
It really does.
That felt a lot more rock and roll than the reality of
and
it.
And then we got a helicopter out of the studio, and that's what we want to hear. That's what we want.
Not quite. I hitchhiked back to the gig. it's nice for a song to have a story. Like when we made our second album, we made a lot of it while we were touring, and it's kind of a nice diary of all the different places we visited along the way in our heads. No one else knows or cares, but to us.
We do care. We definitely care. Something I found really interesting was that you are really inspired in the most random, from what I've seen in other interviews, you're inspired in the most random places with songs. So like you could be anywhere and you have to like sing into your phone.
That's really annoying. And I just look even weirder than I am all the time.
Where's the weirdest place you've ever done?
When Dan first wrote Bad Blood, he had written, I don't know how the writing went, but I remember the first time I heard Bad Blood, he'd got like the track on his phone without vocals, and we were on a night out in Oxford Street and it was quite windy. Ooh. So we squatted behind a bin and then he held his phone up and then sang at me, like, but staring me dead in the eye because we were both a bit drunk. I was like, Dan, this is really uncomfortable, mate, and I can't tell if that's a good song
that
or not.
That is so awful. Yeah.
It's raining.
Please stop looking at me in the eye.
So yeah, that's the sort of thing.
I remember coming up with the bass line for that song.
Dum 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 dum. Like, yeah, cool. I'll play dum 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 dum.
But being in like a toilet in a pub and singing it into my phone, and this poor guy next door must have been so confused.
Who else is now desperate to go on a night out with these two?
Literally no one.
that that to anybody else walking down Oxford Street on that day would have looked like the weirdest. But
and it was
thought?
The weirdest.
Yeah, but look what came out of it. One of your biggest and best hits. Like, that's crazy.
I know, it's worth it.
I mean, if you're up for it, I'm coming a night out. I'm quite rubbish with lyrics. Maybe I could learn something from you guys.
But can you sing bass lines? There
no?
we go.
Not the same
there
thing.
There you go.
Is it? I'm a beatboxer by trade. This is just a side job. You both said, I hope this is true, that your favourite track on the album is 4 AM. Is that right? Am I just judge it?
That was my one.
Oh.
Dan hates it.
Oh God, this is so
No, he
awkward.
Doesn't really.
You think it's fine. It's not your favourite.
No.
It will do.
I'm terrible. I think they're all... I'm like, these should all be singles. What's wrong with everybody? And then the world disagrees.
But that's exactly how you should be, because you should love... You know, you should have love for every single track you make, right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, for sure. And we do. I think with our band, like, we always end up releasing... I kind of... Going forward, I want us to release stuff that sounds totally different to the things we've done before, because I feel like we make these really, really varied albums and then always end up releasing the songs that are, like, maybe the least of a departure on the record. Like, I think from this album, like, Quarter Past Midnight and Joy are potentially the least surprising out of everything else, so... There's something we need to work on.
But I also think, you know, you're delivering in so many ways on the album. You know, you're giving us so much, so many different styles. You're always being influenced, as you said, by films, by things around you. And we can, I don't know whether you guys agree, but I feel like we can feel it in the album. There is so much different there to...
I hope so. But that does require people to listen to the album, though.
which we have... Have we
no,
not
I know you
been
have.
Listening to the album?
Yeah.
Thank you. So in the track Nocturnal Creatures, it has a very 90s feel to it, which I vibe very hard with. It's a real carefree kind of theme. And you quote at the end about rave culture and at the end of the Soviet Union. How do you combine the two and choose sort of cultural quotes and excerpts from it for it?
That was from a documentary that like a really small online documentary by a website that we like about... about Russian rave culture at the end of the Soviet regime, and how, like, suddenly all this culture poured in to this, like, previously quite repressed society. And I just thought it was something about the way that he talks about excess. It was really, I sort of loved the way he chatted about it, this kind of mad old Russian raver. We're like, can we borrow that for our album?
Which is
and often
really
we ask, and everyone's like, absolutely not. We had that when we finished our second album. We'd put all these quotes through the album and had sent them off to get cleared, like, months and months and months in advance. And it turns out whoever's meant to clear them forgot. I was like,
You had one job!
Yeah, despite being quite disorganized, every week I was like, just checking we've got these quotes cleared. And they're like, yeah, someone's got it.
Don't worry.
Anyway, it came down to it, like 4 days before, we had to go and, like, rewrite and recreate so many of them. That wasn't stressful at all.
No.
But as you see, we like to leave things right up to the last minute. But
adds to the magic, though, no?
I think it's just nice to have other, like, I've got quite an annoying voice, so it's quite nice to have other voices wandering in and out of the album, just for a bit of respite, for anyone that's...
I love that he thinks, if you heard me sing, you would never say your voice is annoying. Like, I really know what an annoying voice sounds like. I won't give it to you now, maybe after we've finished. So you guys are off on a major US and Canada tour, which takes off in October, before landing back in the UK in November. How excited are you to get this new album out there to your fans? Because they're clearly very excited.
Yeah, really. Like, we've had a lot of fun putting together... the tour and the show that we've been playing over the summer, and, you know, the tour for America. It's always really fun. It's always really surreal just going to cities that feel very far from home and getting to play to people who like our music.
It's also really nice when you actually get to play to an audience and perform the songs, because it's the first time you really get any kind of intimacy with an audience. And, you know, when you put an album out, you may read some reviews and people may send you tweets and things, but there's something quite visceral about when you actually play a song and someone reacts to it, or a room full of people react to it. So it's the first time you really get a sense of having sort of a connection with the people that you've made?
Like when everybody chooses to go off to the bar or to the toilet, you're like, should have left that one off.
Yeah. We know now for next time. Yeah. On the UK leg, actually, you're on that note, you're kind of visiting a lot of local venues in towns and cities away from the usual touring route. You're hitting up like Carlisle, Grimsby, Torquay, Portsmouth, Margate. Do you prefer those kind of intimate settings? Like you were saying, you can really see and feel what the audience are thinking.
I think A, yes, and B, with this album, we just felt appropriate to do something that felt kind of more intimate and small than these kind of club nights. Like we've spent the first half of the summer playing festivals, and it's amazing playing big stages to lots of people. It's totally surreal and it's kind of otherworldly. But started.
Glastonbury looked insane.
It was crazy. I still can't quite believe that was real life. But getting to play, like, we started out in like pubs and clubs and you know, doing it all ourselves. So I guess with this album that's meant to be quite intimate and meant to be about like a human connection, the idea of doing a tour that is that embodied felt like an exciting idea. And also we've been lucky enough to tour pretty solidly for sort of 6-7 years, and I think we're just wanting to try new things with each one. Nobody in the world was like, oh, I really want that band Bastille to go and do a reorchestrated tour. But we just thought, like, fuck it, it'll be fun. No one else has done it, you know.
Also, I bet your fans are happy.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah.
We had the best time. We had the most amazing time on that tour. It was getting to play with some actual musicians was life changing.
You've released a critically acclaimed album. You're headlining festivals, and you're about to set off on a major tour, like we just said. Do you chill? Do you get any time to relax? Have you slept in the last 5 years?
Well, Dan doesn't, because he's a workaholic, and he'll get home and be like, right, I've got to write loads of songs.
Well, he does it anywhere. He just anywhere gets in the middle of Oxford Street, as we know.
Yeah, I mean, it's been quite a busy summer. But I think I always, whenever I do have time off, I don't know about you, I just like, oh, I want to go and do a gig. Like every night. Every night that I'm at home about 10 o'clock, which is when we'd be going on stage, I get really restless and have to go for a walk.
I just can imagine you just sitting shedding one tear in your living room.
It is.
Guys, thank you so much for joining
us. Thanks for having us. Thanks so much for listening.
We've run out of time, guys. Can you believe this? So I feel like
I thought we were going to get some questions.
I know. We didn't have time because you guys were so great that we didn't have time for any questions. But I can ask you some more afterwards.
That's all right.
No? Leave it then, yeah. Okay, well, Dan and Will from Bastille, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
You can still buy, stream and download Doom Dates right now, and you can catch the boys on their tour. Head to their website for tickets. We're back tomorrow at 4:30 p.m. for a Love Island special. But for now, one last time for Dan and Will.